Hello and welcome to another Torah Tuesday. Today we're tackling a really important question, and that is, what is God's name and what does his name mean? We're going to be in Exodus chapter 3, verses 13 to 15. Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you.' And they ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what shall I tell them?" God said to Moses, "Ehyeh asher ehyeh." This is what you are to say to the Israelites. Ehyeh has sent me to you. Now that Hebrew sentence that I just said, Ehyeh asher ehyeh, we could translate, "I am who I am," or "I will be whoever I will be," which is a way of answering and not answering the question at the same time. God saying to Moses, "I am going to show you who I am. You're going to have to wait and see." And so it's an invitation for Moses to press in and continue to pay attention, because God hasn't quite answered the question yet. Verse 15 says, "God also said to Moses, 'Say to the Israelites, Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation.'" So here he actually, in verse 15, he gives the actual name of God, Yahweh. Now, we don't often think of God having a name. We call him God or Lord, both of which are titles, not names. But it's really important here, theologically significant, that God is giving Moses his personal name. By giving Moses his personal name, God is inviting Moses to be on a first-name basis. He's inviting Moses into more intimate relationship with him. And in that cultural context, to give someone your name is to give them access to your power. And I'm thinking here specifically of an Egyptian text that's called The Legend of Isis and the Name of Re, that gives us a glimpse of this dynamic at work. Isis is trying to figure out Re's real name. The gods have like street names that they're known by, but they're not their real names. And if you know their real name, then you have access to their power. And in a sense, for God to just offer Moses his name and say, "My name is Yahweh, that's what you can call me," is like making himself vulnerable to Moses and to the Israelites. Putting himself at risk of being abused or misused. So it's really significant that God is bonding to them in this way. Now, there's been a lot of debate about what the name Yahweh actually means. We could translate it "He is" or "He will be." But the problem is, when we use someone's name, we're rarely thinking of the meaning of the name in the sense of its etymology or origins, like its dictionary definition. When you say the name Carmen, or when you hear the name Carmen, you think of the things you know about me based on what I've done. You're not usually thinking about the fact that it's a name of Spanish descent that means song or beautiful song. That's not the association you have with me. You probably think of me in relation to Torah Tuesday or something like that. Bible teacher, Old Testament, or mom, or something, depending on the kind of relationship that we have. So in fact, the name Yahweh, I don't think it's helpful for us to spend time wrestling over the origin of the name or what its dictionary meaning is. The name Yahweh is like an empty shell that's going to be filled with meaning throughout the rest of the book of Exodus. God is about to reveal to Moses and to the Israelites and to the Egyptians what sort of person he is, and he's going to do that by acting on their behalf, by taking action in history. So I'm depending here on the work of a friend of mine named Austin Searles. His dissertation is Making Sense of the Divine Name in Exodus, from Etymology to Literary Onomastics. Onomastics is a fancy way of saying the meanings of names and why we name people what we name them. So he says we need to go, instead of debating about the origin of the word Yahweh and what the word Yahweh means, we need to look at the literary context in which it's used, and because that is the place that Yahweh reveals himself. So he argues that we don't know the meaning of the name Yahweh in Exodus chapter 3. We have to hang in there for the rest of the story to find out what Yahweh means. And what we discover is that Yahweh is the God who hears the cry of the oppressed. He delivers them from slavery in Egypt. He demonstrates his power to Pharaoh. He's the God who takes sin seriously. He's the God who shows mercy to those who repent. He's the God whose greatest desire is to dwell among his people and have an intimate relationship with them and equip them to be his ambassadors to the nations. That's who Yahweh is. But we don't know that in Exodus chapter 3. We're only at the beginning. And God is in effect saying to Moses, lean in, keep listening. I'm about to show you who I am. Now, when you're reading along in English, if you want to know where the name Yahweh appears in Hebrew, all you have to do is look for the word Lord in all capital letters. Every time you see Lord in all caps, that is an indication that you're looking at the divine name Yahweh in Hebrew. And so that's the translator's way of showing you what's happening in Hebrew. I wish that our English translations would just say Yahweh whenever the biblical text says Yahweh, but there's a long tradition of not pronouncing God's name in order to show respect. While I want to show God respect, I see in this passage a bold invitation for God's people to call him by name. He's inviting Moses and inviting the Israelites to remember him by name forever from generation to generation. And I think that that invitation extends to us. So my practice when I'm reading the biblical text aloud is to substitute the name Yahweh every time I see Lord in all capital letters to remind me of that wonderful truth that God is inviting us into intimate relationship with him. That's our insight for this week. I absolutely love your comments. Thanks to those of you who've been leaving me comments down below. You can do that anytime. Tell me what you liked about the video, ask me questions, or share insights that you've learned as you've been reading the biblical text. I would love to hear them. Have a great week.